Hello everyone, Narcissist Free Almost here, and today I wanted to talk about the intrapsychic structure of the narcissist, and how they got that way, according to object relations theory. Some of the material will be redundant, but I do think it's worth repeating. Also, just a quick mention of pronoun usage. When I refer to he, you can easily replace that with she. It's just easier to use he, than keep typing he or she, etc. By the end of this video, you'll see the fixation point of their pathological development, and how this disorder will not likely be fixed with any amount of help or love. However, like any other disorder like schizophrenia or autism, it can only be managed. But first, we have to understand the depressive position. This process is vital to integration, where the processes of projection and introjection cycle both good and bad aspects of an object into an integrated whole. Recall, some important ego functions such as self-awareness, reality testing, memory with recollection of conflicting impulses and ideas, and regulation of affect. Also recall that the ego and the self ride in tandem, so if the ego is split, also known as pathological, the self is split, and vice versa. Now, if emerging depressive anxiety is countered by manic and obsessional defenses, there may be a retreat into the paranoid schizoid position, and remember, in this position, it's strictly about survival of the self. If this becomes rigidly established, it will prevent a full working through of the depressive position. So, I would think around the ages of 3 to 6 months, if one is to show signs of pathological behavior, here is where you would begin to see it. But what exactly would you be looking for, and furthermore, what steps could you take to alleviate this position? Those are big questions for sure. But as the infant works through the depressive position, you should see an emerging ambivalence, which is an emerging anxiety that infant's own impulses hurt the loved object he depends on. The more integrated infant, that can retain love for the good object, even while hating it, will be exposed to new feelings, namely mourning and pining for the good object felt as lost and destroyed, and guilt that he has lost the good object through his own destructive impulses. At the height of ambivalence, the infant is exposed to depressive despair. He remembers he has loved, and still does love his mother, but feels he has devoured or destroyed her. Furthermore, the infant feels he has destroyed her internally and left her in bits, which leads to feelings of helplessness and hopelessness. Keep in mind, all of this description of the depressive position is the abandonment depression that Masterson is talking about when describing the disorders of the self triad, where self-activation leads to anxiety and depression, which then leads to defense. In essence, the borderline, narcissist, and schizoid are avoiding these feelings as if their lives depended on it, much like the infant does in the paranoid schizoid position. This is where things go awry, or pathological, for the borderline, narcissist, and schizoid. Because the next step in growth is integration, there should be the wish to repair the destroyed object in the infant's omnipotent fantasy. There should be a wish to restore and regain his lost objects, giving them life and wholeness, believing his own attacks are responsible for the destructiveness of his object. And he will also believe his one love and care can undo the effects of his aggression. This is the depressive conflict, that is the constant struggle between his own love and reparative impulses, and his own destructiveness. Failure of reparation leads to despair, and alternatively success leads to renewed hope. Successful reparation leads to a radical alteration of reality, ego is more integrated and projections lessen. The infant becomes aware of himself and his own impulses and fantasies, and begins to distinguish between internal and external reality. Moreover, as the ego becomes more integrated, so the self follows. For the personality disordered, the fixation point is just before the depressive position is fully worked through. Here, you will have a split ego, and failure in mourning that leads to other feelings, such as ambivalence, needed to start the reparation cycle. In my experience, of all the narcissists I've known, they never fully mourned in any sustained or meaningful way. Which explains why narcissists can so easily move on from one relationship to another. Sure, They display seemingly appropriate emotions because, as we all know, they're gifted actors and will exploit anyone or any situation to garner their much-needed supply. Plus, they are very aware of societal expectations. But, I was often dismayed at the lack of depth, or absence of any proper length of time during the mourning periods. If you think about it, we mourn frequently loved and lost objects. Imagine losing your phone, or your keys, and most people will go through the five stages of grief, albeit swiftly, but grieve nonetheless. However, if you observe the narcissist closely, they really don't. Remember, losing something then angrily blaming someone else is not the same thing as the stages of grief. They lack attachment to things or consequences, and this makes them appear impervious to life's little and big stressors. One thing that's the saddest, for me anyway, is the absence of sentimentality. Ever notice that? For example, way back when my ex-narc one claimed a special bond with his grandfather. He even kept one of his grandfather's tools, a hammer with his initials on it, and claimed it was a sentimental item. Being the discarder narcissist that he was, when he left me and his children, he only took his clothes. He never asked for pictures of the kids, nothing, just took his clothes. I kept waiting for him to take some of his other stuff, especially his beloved hammer. But he never once asked about it. Months later, he did call for one specific item, and that was a signed copy of Pumping Iron by Arnold Schwarzenegger. Why would he want this and nothing else? Well, because it had an obvious monetary value. Another example, involving ex-narc too, was his complete absence of mourning. Oh, he'd put on a show for his audience and might even be able to squeeze out a tear or two, but there was a total absence of mourning. I observed this when his mother passed away. Here was the golden child, mommy's boy, and her death had no impact on him whatsoever, the day after, and every day after that, nothing. No sentiment, no depression, no anger, nothing, and I found it quite disturbing to witness. Next, I would like to talk a little bit about the difference between arrested development and pathological development. Arrested development is described as being stuck at an emotional level of development depending on the timing of a trauma, and I would add addiction, in childhood or adolescence. Pathological development, which is established within the first year of life, is understood as normal development gone awry. This includes, but not limited to, schizophrenia, autism, and personality disorders, characterized by abnormality and dysfunction. Keep in mind, the first can be overcome, whereas the second can only be managed. No amount of love or therapy can cure a pathological disorder. As is in the case of NARC 2, without a doubt, he is pathological and it's highly likely his childhood development was anything but normal. As with most narcissists, they either embellish their childhoods, or won't talk about them at all. True to form, NARC 2 kept everything secret. Furthermore, NPD would be missed in infancy because appropriate emotional developmental milestones are subtle, and subject to projections and misinterpretations. Events such as mourning and pining, ambivalence and guilt could be missed, if you even knew to look for such things. So, I've talked about issues related to not fully working through the depressive position, and the difference between arrested development and pathological development. When one has not integrated as a result of working through the depressive position, such a person will inevitably fall back on infantile defensive behaviors such as projection, and splitting to name a few. If one has a split ego, also known as a pathological ego, then the self will be split apart as well. Someone who is immature wouldn't necessarily use such primitive defenses all of the time. I think it's important to make these distinctions, that is, that someone can be developmentally arrested, but not pathological. However, someone who is pathological will definitely be developmentally arrested. Furthermore, Masterson specifically names NPD as narcissistic personality disorder of the self with emphasis on the self for a reason. The real self is what Masterson believes is what you need to get at in order to heal the disorder under all its pathology. With that in mind, Remember, the self and the ego ride tandem, so if the ego is pathologized, so is the self. And since the object representation was not fully integrated in the depressive position, you have everything in opposition, good, bad, all or nothing, etc. For the narcissist, the internalized mother object is either omnipotent or harsh and attacking. And the narcissist's self is either grandiose consistent with the omnipotent mother, or inadequate and unworthy consistent with the devaluing mother. It has to be one or the other, because of the use of the defense mechanism splitting. Again, this defense is to keep the effects apart to avoid feeling abandonment depression. I like to think of it sort of like when I experienced cognitive dissonance, where there is terrible anxiety produced when you try to hold two competing realities. Anyone who has had the misfortune of knowing a narcissist will have had this experience. The whiplash the narcissist gives you when switching from one persona to another, and the confusion you will suffer from the pathological lying, will cause terrible anxiety and confusion. Inevitably, their split realities will cause a split within you, before you fully realize what's really going on. And it is through this experience of cognitive dissonance I sort of get what's going on, all the time, within the borderline, or narcissist. Does that make sense? Now, back to the fixation point, and what does this mean besides infantile defenses? This means, for the narcissist, a very tenuous relationship with reality, where you have the dread of slipping back into the paranoid schizoid position, in other words, insanity. This means there is no development of higher emotional functions such as empathy, concern for others, moral reasoning, emotional memory, and so forth. Remember the lack of sentimentality I talked about earlier? That would be tied to emotional memory, or lack thereof. So, imagine a grown person, with the psychology of an infant. That is what you're dealing with if you're with a narcissist. Those of us who've been there and done that, do not find it hard to imagine, unfortunately. Now you can see why it's always about them, and how they harbor a mentality of scarcity. That is, that of supply to go around, and how they must have it all, at all times. You can also see how people wouldn't recognize this disorder until this person reaches young adulthood. Teenage years, and even 20s are seen as inherently narcissistic because of youth, and vitality mostly. So some selfish behaviors are overlooked by society somewhat. But when you get older and see this disorder through the eyes of maturity, you can start to see NPD for what it is. Furthermore, intellectually a pathologized person will gain and build knowledge, making them appear as if they are fully functioning when they are not, and that's the tricky part, and where I think they can fool most of us. They can easily recall facts and dates, but are unable to tell you how they felt during an emotional event. In other words, the words are there but the music is not, which will give you that off feeling. Sadly, this is where psychologists totally miss the mark, and are taken for the proverbial ride, because the prevailing attitude would be don't pick on the narcissist, they're just not in touch with their feelings. When the truth is, their feelings run their life. You have to look at them through the proper lens, and that is you're dealing with an infant who's incapable of higher functioning emotions. Lacks empathy, of course, and it intellectually capable of fooling almost everyone with their constant projections. Just try to reason with a 2-year-old, not gonna happen. Lastly, what I want to express here is that whether this disorder is a result of pathological development or arrested development or simply dealing with an infant or child at best, are you really going to give them keys to your car, so to speak? They cheat to win, thinking that that's being clever. They're short-sighted, impulsive, cruel, manipulative, and just plain dangerous. If you've identified one, the best advice you'll ever hear is no contact. Add to that, never look back. Get out, stay out, and keep them out. Wow. That was a bit of a rambler, and I hope that made sense. And as your understanding of the intrapsychic structure of the narcissist grows, with all its primitive defenses, you can see that no amount of help or understanding can help the narcissist do anything like have insight, remorse, or even a conscience. It's just not possible. Well, that's it for now, and I do hope that helped someone. Please remember to like, subscribe and comment. Feel free to follow me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and Instagram at Clumber_Lover with a U. And as always, all my love and gratitude, hoping you've found peace of mind narcissist free. I know. I have.